So you have an understanding of what Kubernetes is, and today you're going to learn how to work with it locally using MiniCube and build your first Kubernetes cluster. For us to get started working with Kubernetes locally, we're going to use a utility that the Kubernetes team has created called MiniCube, which will spin up a local cluster that we can interact with in the same way we would interact with a Kubernetes cluster in the cloud. There are a few minor exceptions to how this is going to be different, but for the most part, it'll feel very much the same. Before we can get started with that, though, we need to install the CoopCTL command, which this is the Kubernetes command line client. So you're going to come down here and install just the binary, copy the curl command for your particular operating system, and then paste this. It'll download the binary, which is prepackaged. Now that we have it downloaded, we're going to make it executable. And then finally, we're going to move it into our path. So I'm going to put it in user local bin. And now I can actually use the kubectl command line. The next thing that we're going to do is we're going to come to the releases section of MiniCube, and we're going to grab the latest one here. It has similar curl instructions to the way that the kubectl worked, so we'll just grab this and paste it. And this has the moving baked in, but I don't want to use sudo, so I'm going to back that out and then run this. Now that we have MiniCube installed, we can start it with MiniCube start. This will build a local Kubernetes cluster in a VM. Like I said, I'm using VirtualBox. Go to the MiniCube README to figure out what you need to have installed. But if you've been working with Docker, you should have any of the VM's software necessary installed already. With MiniCube started and our cluster running, we can now actually create our first deployment inside of Kubernetes. So underneath deployments are pods, which are essentially the services that you're used to looking at in Docker Compose. Like, they hold on to that extra information, like what kind of network connections do you need and what are the volumes that you access and what images do you run. So that's underneath the deployment, and then the deployment is in charge of running that. So if you think about it that way, we can use kubectl run, and then this will be the name of our deployment, not necessarily what's underneath it. We're going to call it web server. And then we have to give it an image in this case, since we're not using a pod file yet. And we're going to use the Nginx Alpine image just because it's small. So that created the deployment. I already had the image downloaded. It didn't have to do that for me. Let's take a look at what the deployment actually looks like. We can use kubectl get, and then each of the resources inside of Kubernetes can be accessed this way. So you can get at pods, or we're going to look at deployments right now. So get deployments, and you'll see that we have one. We called it web server, and it's currently available, and it's been up for about 40 seconds. Now, if we do the same thing with pods, we can see that underneath we have a single pod called web server with this extra stuff, and this is because we didn't create a named pod. We used an image for it, so it created this for us. And we're only running one, and it is currently running. So the neat thing about deployments is that they're in charge of keeping your pods running. So if we grab this particular pod, and we use another kubectl command of delete, and we delete a pod, it's going to be this particular one. And then we look at our pods again. You'll notice that it's not the same one. It has a different SHA on the end. And that's because the deployment was in charge of spinning that back up. Having a pod is great, but it's not super useful unless we can actually access it. So the way that we're going to access this is by creating a service. And the Kubernetes command to do that is going to be expose. So we're going to use kubectl expose. And we want to expose the entire deployment named web server. And we're going to give it a type and call it load balancer. That way, if we had multiple pods running inside this deployment, it would load balance them for us. And then we're also gonna map the port to 80. If we look at our services now using get services, we have it running. And this is one of the areas where it's going to be a little different running here than it would be in the cloud. And that is, we can't really have an external IP. There's not going to be anything here that we could connect directly to this port 80. If you were using this exact same command in something like Google Cloud or AWS, it could actually give you an external IP and you could connect to that directly. So in our case, we need to connect to this port, but that's a little bit weird because we also have to go to the IP address for our MiniCube. Thankfully, MiniCube provides a single short command in order to give us access to their services. So if we say MiniCube service, and then you give it the name of the service, which is web server in our case, and then you just want the URL, this will print out the IP address of the MiniCube VM and then the port that they mapped your service to. So if we copy this and we go and open it in our web browser, we see the Nginx default page. So that's your first deployment. You deployed an Nginx image inside of Kubernetes and have it load balanced behind a service. We went through that kind of fast, and there are quite a few little parts behind Kubernetes, and something that it might be useful to do is to kind of visualize those. Thankfully, Kubernetes can have dashboards in front of it, and Minikube comes with one such dashboard. So if we say Minikube dashboard, it will actually open it for us, and we can take a look at all of our deployments, pods, and even services in a visual manner here. That was a bit of a whirlwind tour of using Minikube and Kubernetes locally, but if there are things that you take out of this, just know that the kubectl command line builds in kind of a sentence structure. So kubectl get will give you access to the types of resources that Kubernetes has, pods, deployments, services, etc. Kubectl delete will do a similar thing if you want to get rid of them. So if we want to get rid of our web server, we could say delete service web server. And now if we kubectl get services, you'll see that it's no longer there. That was a pretty quick tour of Kubernetes and Minikube, but I hope you learned something from this. If you enjoyed this video, then don't forget to like it and give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends if you want to. Leave some comments below and tell me how you're going to be using Kubernetes and what the first project you're going to use it with is. Have a nice week.